press the bell icon on the YouTube app to never miss a video from News Laundry. This is a News Laundry podcast and you're listening to NL Hafta.
Angrez apna lagan aur News Laundry apna hafta kabhi nahi chhodte. We are back on the hafta. Before I introduce the panel, I would like to apologize. You see the ignorance that one has of caste privilege. We didn't have any external panelists last time and there was just the four of us in-house. So I had introduced us as the Chandal Chokri. That is a casteist slur. I wasn't even aware that Chandal is actually a caste.
It is a caste.
So I would like to apologize for that. I shall not describe our in-house panel as that in future. So yes, as my Buddhist friend used to say, recall and cancel. I said, what does that mean? That means you've pulled your words back from the universe and canceled them. I said, okay, fine. So this podcast is being recorded on Thursday, the 16th of July at 12:15 in the afternoon. This time we have a much more accomplished panel with two people joining us from outside the office. We have Suhasini Haider joining us from her home in these COVID times.
Hi, Abhinandan.
I'm sure all our listeners already know who you are, but we have to follow the formality of introducing you as a diplomatic editor of Hindu. You write on foreign policy issues. In fact, you have been a foreign policy expert for a long time. You're a foreign affairs editor and the prime anchor for India's, you know, English channel CNN IBN. In fact, you had a show called Worldview with Suhasini Haider. And you have also won the Prem Bhatia Award for print journalism. So welcome. And you have written a couple of pieces, in fact, in the last 2 weeks on several foreign policy issues. We shall discuss that in a little more detail. We also have joining us Anand Vardhan from Patna. Hi, Anand.
Hello.
Anand is an accomplished writer and he is also a teacher. And Guru ki izzat karna hamara dharm hai. So welcome, Guruji. I believe, although the numbers of COVID in Bihar are suddenly alarmingly going haywire, is it more testing or is there something has happened?
There are two, three factors at work. First, yes, testing has scaled up. And yesterday was the first day when 10,000 tests were carried in a single day. There is also a perception that when lockdown was slackened or relaxed, It was a period when mass migration, reverse migration to Bihar happened, and that was not the time for the lockdown to be relaxed. And since the contribution of migrants returning is high in the number of infected cases, there is a correlation being established between the two factors.
I see. So in-house, we have Raman Kripal.
Hello.
Mehraj Lone.
Hello.
Manisha Pandey.
Hello.
And I'm Abhinandan Sekri. So before Manisha gives us the headlines, just a couple of announcements. For the next 3 or 4 weeks, Haftas will be free. They'll be outside the paywall. I hope this doesn't disincentivize those of you who are subscribing and paying. We have thousands of paying subscribers, guys. We can only exist because of you. So don't say, ab mufat ka mil raha hai, so I will stop paying. This is happening because, as you know, we've moved to a new content management system. We are moving to a new website, a new UI UX. In the process of that, just the process by which subscribers get the Hafta behind the paywall has become a little patchy because our podcast player is not like integrating so well with our new website. So a lot of subscribers are having problem accessing it. So we've just made it free for everybody till that time. It'll be back behind the paywall. But I do hope you continue to pay.
And you can share these free ones with your friends and family and get them hooked and then get them to subscribe when we're back.
Yes. Try to do that.
Be our Amway.
In fact, we have, you know, many people who are working on our podcasts. There's Snigdha, there's Aditya, there's Lippi, there's Harshula, you know, all the panelists. So these people just need to be incentivized, and sometimes they ask for salaries. So do consider subscribing.
My God.
Can you imagine this generation of entitled salary wanters? All you Sachin Pilot types. But
the proper term is wage slaves.
Wage slaves. Okay, wage slaves. And meanwhile, we have another NL Sena project coming up. The brutal killing of Jairaj and his son Benix in Tamil Nadu brought the spotlight back on custodial deaths. Per a recent report, India saw on average 5 custodial deaths every day in 2019. Why is there such an endemic problem? And we are going to be launching an NL Sena project to do a deep, you know, investigation into this. And Raman sir, our managing editor, is an expert in doing stories that involve the police. So do contribute and make sure that we have enough resources to put enough reporters to do this report. And if Raman sir gets arrested, we should also be able to afford lawyers to get him out. And finally, I would like to give a shout out to Geeta Janardhan, who supported 1 year worth of student subscriptions. So
wow.
Thanks, Geeta. You know, many of our students who are not earning can't pay to get access to paywalled content. So we have a system where they can send us their ID card, their college name, so we have certainty that they're college students. And many of you who are earning actually sponsor these student subscriptions.
That's amazing.
So Geeta has just sent 1 year worth of student subscription for a person. So thanks, Geeta.
Thank you, Geeta Janardhan. Thank you so much for sponsoring our student membership subscriptions. If anyone of you listening to this podcast would also like to support a student subscription, please write into us at contact@newslaundry.com and we'll take that ahead. Of course, if you want to leave any feedback and if you want to write into us at contact@newslaundry.com or you could tweet to us at our Twitter handles.
On that note, let's have the headlines, Manisha.
Yes, Game of Thrones season 5 or 6 or I don't know what in Rajasthan.
Unending.
The recent development on that is that the rebel leader Sachin Pilot has been sacked as the deputy chief minister and removed as the state party chief. Rajasthan Assembly Speaker has also sent notice to Pilot and 18 of his MLA allies demanding response in 2 days or risk disqualification. This is pertaining to Gehlot's claim that he has two MLAs from Pilot's camp on phone negotiating with the BJP toppling the government. Meanwhile, in Madhya Pradesh, Sindhya is having a good time. Shivraj Singh Chauhan allocated portfolios and his camp has got key ministries. On the LAC standoff, there's news now there was a report in the Indian Express that said that the first intel on PLA came mid-April, long before the Pangong clash. India and China will hold its fourth round of consultation. First phase of disengagement is completed. Now focuses on the second phase. Also on the LAC standoff, officials have said that months of planning and coordination preceded Chinese border movement. So it's going to be probably tough to negotiate them to go back. Iran has dropped India from the Chabahar rail project and cites funding delay. That's big news. That didn't really get much coverage, but it's big news. Meanwhile, a comedian in Mumbai, Agrima, she's a female comedian. She got rape threats and she was really harassed and bullied for jokes involving Shivaji Maharaj. I think she may also face legal action. At least that's what the Home Minister Anil Deshmukh said. Lakhs have been displaced in Assam floods. National parks have been hit. This is an yearly sort of a phenomena. In the Tablighi Jamaat case, Delhi court has allowed foreigners from 5 countries to walk free with fine. HRD minister has launched world's most affordable COVID-19 test kit developed by IIT Delhi. I didn't know that.
In fact, it was announced
It's called
yesterday.
Koroshore. Meanwhile, in Nepal, Prime Minister KP Sharma said Lord Ram was Nepali, not Indian. I thought there was confusion about where Sita was born and I think that was Nepal, but I didn't know there was a confusion on Ram also. Google
this
is
whole
going
idea
to...
of Nepal and India, I mean, you're talking about it today. There was no Nepal and India back then.
Google to invest in Jio platforms. Mukesh Ambani has become the 6th richest person in the world, says Jio has developed 5G from scratch in India. Great news for international students and even Indian students studying in the US. The whole policy on having to go back if there's an online course has been revoked.
By Trump, yeah. After so many universities.
And a letter by NYT opinion editor Barry Weiss created a lot of flutter on Twitter. Maybe we can discuss that. She's quit the NY Times. She was one of the conservative op-ed writers and she cited bullying by colleagues in an illiberal environment at the NYT.
Probably one of the worst columnists New York Times has had since I started reading.
I don't mind her. I like some
She's
of her stuff.
She's utterly, I wouldn't say dumb, but I mean her writing is so lazy and cliched and I mean.
So in fact, we'll talk about that and I would like, I've been waiting, but I want to start off with this piece that Suhasini wrote in The Hindu, Iran drops India from the Chabahar rail projects, cites funding delay. Now, in context of this, Suhasini, there is much speculation happening that is our handling of foreign affairs been, you know, really good, that we have a new place and respect and awe in the world. In fact, recently another journalist, I think it was Shivam, if I'm not wrong, from print, tweeted a quote of, it wasn't Pompey, but someone in the White House who said that, you know, Trump will decide whether he wants to back China or India in our skirmish. I mean, of course, it wasn't an official
statement.
I think
it was John Bolton who said that,
right.
I'm not sure which way Trump would lean.
Right. So now, why is this Iran deal so important and has yet got such little airtime on our prime time? Is it significant as far as foreign relations goes?
Well, let's first understand, and thanks so much for pointing out my story, because as you did say, a lot of foreign policy issues don't get as much coverage. And then suddenly when things blow up, people say, where was this coming from? I don't mean blow up literally. I just mean when a story gets bigger. So basically what happened, and that was the story we did, was that in 2016, India and particularly the Indian Railways construction company, IRCON, signed an MOU with the Iranian Railways in the presence of Prime Minister Modi when he had gone to Tehran to say, we will build this railway line for you. The railway line goes from Chabahar port, which is, of course, is a very important project for India for a number of strategic reasons, which is in Iran's southern coast. And we essentially are building one terminal over there right now, and we have another terminal to build. So we were going to build this railway line that goes from the southern coast of Iran to Afghanistan. And if you've got a map in your mind or in front of you somewhere, it can also then extend up to Turkmenistan. What this essentially means is there's nothing on the land right now. There's nothing on the ground, nothing on paper, in fact, at that time. But that this could become India's geostrategic doorway to Central Asia, to Russia, a way of bypassing Pakistan, which is always a troublesome neighbor. So a lot of different reasons why this railway line could open up a lot. But nothing happened. For 4 years, we didn't move. Some say it's because the funding took a while to work out. Some say it's because the Iranians kept changing the terms of contract. Some say it's because of U.S. sanctions. And the idea that even if the U.S. had given us a waiver to build the line, to buy steel, you need a different kind of permission. To get banking loans, you need a different kind of permission. For whatever reason, for 4 years, nothing moved. And then suddenly, and after many, we heard many warnings, appeals, threats from Iranian leadership saying, you know, we need to move with this rail project. We suddenly saw last week that Iran actually went ahead and began the track laying for Chabahar Zahedan on their own. And that was essentially what my story was, that Iran decided to go alone. And they told us officially that they were actually going to build the railway line on their own. And India, if it wants to, can join later. But India had not shown any interest. Why this hurts India, or why it affects India, or should we care about it? I think there are two parts to it. One is you don't want to be cut out of any geostrategic game at this time. And so there is the kind of FOMO, if you like, the fear of missing out in Iran, especially when a country like China is signing a massive deal with them. But there's also the more significant part, that this was going to be your work around Pakistan. So what happens to that grand plan? The third is a reputational damage, because India is loved around the world. We have a lot of goodwill. But, you know, there is this idea that Indian delivery on its promises is not very good. And this looks like one more reason to say so. Finally, the fact that Iran didn't actually wait for us essentially means that somewhere there we've lost influence. Now, is that influence being lost because of domestic factors? Because, you know, Iran has made a lot of comments on Jammu and Kashmir and on the CAA and all the rest. Or is it essentially because of India's positioning with the United States that Iran is spurring Iran to feel that maybe India is not going to keep its traditional ties there? So in a nutshell, it's a small thing in terms of all the projects that India might be doing around the world. It's one railway line, 628 kilometers long, but it could have many larger repercussions. And that's essentially what the story was about.
So quickly, if you could just tell me, from your reporting and your understanding of the situation, is the delay because of economic reasons, because the economy has been hit significantly, and not just COVID, even pre-COVID, we weren't exactly kicking ass?
Well, I mean, can India afford a project like this? Yes, India can. I mean, we had outlaid $1.6 billion for the railway line. But in honesty, Iran says it's building it at $400 million right now. I mean, the point is, you start somewhere. You start, you don't have to pay that entire amount immediately. No, it's much more likely that, given that India has always been worried about U.S. sanctions, and remember, India became one of the countries that just dropped Iran. Iran used to be our third largest oil provider, particularly because of the kind of cheap rates of oil that we used to get from Iran. But when the U.S. threatened sanctions, our first response was to say, no, we don't accept U.S. sanctions. We only accept U.N. sanctions. But within a year of that, we had actually dropped all oil. We zeroed out our oil imports from Iran. So having given in over there, it does seem to me that probably we didn't feel like fighting for this one either.
So, Anand, I know you follow foreign policy probably the most out of all of us here. You want to weigh in on this? How significant is this in the longer run or in our foreign policy positioning?
First, I think the report itself has been contested by what I see in Al Jazeera, which it says that Iran denied an Indian newspaper report that New Delhi was dropped from a key rail project along the border with Afghanistan after it showed reluctance in investing, fearing American sanctions. And it quotes Iran's Ports and Maritime Organization Deputy Farhad Montasir, and who calls it a totally false that Iran has not inked any deal with India regarding the Jahedan Jabal Railway. So I don't know what is the actual position.
Could I
just
to say that it actually confirms the report in a sense. It's just Iran is putting it differently. Iran is saying the MOU was never turned into an agreement, and therefore India is not a part of the railway deal. However, I think there are many things that would contest that point of view. Firstly, Javed Zarif, the Iranian foreign minister, came as recently as January this year and once again appealed to India to be a part of the deal. Secondly, MEA officials have told us that the MOU is still on, it has not been cancelled, and that India does hope that it can be a part of the deal later on. So I think what has happened is essentially people have used what the ports authority person has said about the railway to make it seem as if it's not true that India was knocked out. Actually, what they're saying is worse. They're saying India was never a part of the Chabahar Jahedan railway line, which actually should be of greater worry, I think, for India than anything else.
I see. Thanks. Cool. So go ahead, Anand.
So in light of this, the Al Jazeera report and the contentious nature of what India has been actually dropped from, or whether it was a part of the deal or not, I think an authoritative clarification from the Ministry of External Affairs spokesperson is required, and a more clear communication from, say, the topmost diplomatic circles would do a lot of good in what is actually India's stand on it. Second, it may be talked down now, but at one point, as Suhasini was pointing out, it was one of the signature moves of India in Central Asia, and it was billed as key strategic measure, particularly bypassing Pakistan. It was also built for its utility in ensuring energy supplies. Also, it was seen as a counter to the water port, which had a Chinese involvement. And so, in a way, the paper like Al Jazeera report quotes American interests. One thing that also should be taken into consideration is that it is also a period in which India has cozied up to Israel, and in a way that after, say, in early part of this century, during Vajpayee's regime, after say a hiatus of 1.5 decades, around 14-15 years, so the new terms of engagement with Israel can also be one of the factors of a kind of estrangement with Iran. And that has also, I think, a bit reconfigured the diplomatic dynamics in Central Asia.
Right. And you want to step in before we move on?
Hi, Suhasini Maharaj.
Hey, hi.
Hi. So you mentioned this aspect of the India's relationship with America and how that has affected this. If I remember correctly, this was also the case when that India-Pakistan-Iran pipeline was being discussed, oil pipeline. And it was said at the time that it was because of the US pressure that it had to be dropped, and Manishankar Iyer even lost his job as the petroleum minister. But after that pivot, that under Obama, that US will pivot more to South China Sea, that Southeast Asia region, and not so much focus on Middle East. So is that dynamic still there, that the US pressure on India not to engage with what it considers hostile powers in the Middle East and like actively pressures India not to engage with them. Is that dynamic still there or has that eased off somewhat?
Well, you know, the Americans always have a wish list. And they had a wish list for us a couple of years ago on Iran, which was essentially to do three things. One was to stop oil, all oil imports from Iran. The second was to basically, you know, stop projects in Iran, things like the gas and other infrastructure projects we were working on. And the third actually was one place where they gave in, which was on Chabahar, because India explained to them that the Chabahar port would help Afghanistan because Pakistan was cutting off India's links, trade links to Afghanistan. So that was their wish list. Whether they're pushing for anything right now would be hard to say. But you know, what's happened is there is this cascading effect of any sanctions, because what ends up happening is even if a country wants to go ahead with something, unless you're completely immune to the to global trade and to trade with the US, which does trade with absolutely everyone, it's very hard to find the banks to give you loans or to open an LC of credit for you or to find equipment manufacturers. You know, there's been one point where India put out three tenders, I think, for just for cranes, for heavy lifting cranes. Eventually had to plump for a Chinese company to do that. So whether or not it's a direct pressure, the fact is it becomes very difficult to work when the US doubles down on its sanctions. And at present, the US is making Iran a particular focus of its sanctions. So I think that does have an impact on us.
Okay. Now, if we could just move on to China briefly, and then I won't be discussing foreign policy, but there's one thing, Suhasini, I would like you to weigh in on, but we'll just come to that. Now, when it comes to China, I think this is one of those stories that is, even for news professionals like me, very difficult to get clarity on what the status is. One reason is you can't send your own reporter there to see what's happening because no one can get there except the army. Two, the government has lost all credibility. I mean, it's not like anyone believed the government handouts earlier, but now it's gone to the level of jo tum din ko kahu raat to raat kahenge. It's gone.
They're not even giving out handouts now. It's just like official sources. No statements, nothing is coming.
And because the environment is so polarized, so I have the utmost respect and affection for Ajay, and he's been on Hafta 2-3 weeks ago. But I know other journalists who also I like, and I have no reason to really doubt them. And there are too many contradictory things being said about the pullback. One is that the pullback is, we have pulled back to a position that is a compromise for us, that where we were in the past historically patrolling, now we can't patrol. China has pulled back to where they used to patrol anyway. So they haven't gone further back from where they were, let's say, 2 years ago, but we have. And at the same time, the pullback from their point of view, they're still building, they're still reinforcing the heights at Pangong. Is there any clarity that you as a foreign affairs editor can provide on something like this? Or do we live in this, shady world of not knowing what to believe?
Fog of war.
Well, let's put it this way. The fact is that the one sort of credible way of finding out should be those satellite pictures. But the honest truth is, I think the satellite pictures are being read by various experts to essentially tell you what they already believe. Because I don't think we understand. There was one point at which they were fighting about not whether the tents were in a place, but whether those tents belonged to India or whether they belonged to China. So I think we haven't got much clarity on that. Look, as far as the reports go, let's be clear over here. Whether or not you accept what certain journalists, and you mentioned Ajay, but others, many others have said, the truth is that they were saying as early May that there was a problem, that the problem was not like a routine problem because Chinese troops had aggressed in 5 different areas, that there were much larger numbers, that the skirmishes that we saw in Pangong, so for example, on May 5th was brutal. I mean, you had 70 Indian soldiers injured to the point they had to be flown to hospitals. And these were being reported by the Hindu as well and by others. And yet the government kept saying, what was it the government was saying? Mid-May, the army chief said, these are routine clashes. We heard from other members in the government who routinely were denying stories coming out, saying there's nothing going on. Finally, we heard even from the prime minister saying, nobody has come in, na koi ghusa hai, na ghusaya hai. So this has been the government position, The fact is, until 20 Indian soldiers died in the Galwan Valley on June 15th, actually nobody was speaking. And I think Manisha referred to those reports, that actually intelligence reports to this had come in mid-April. So for 2 months, the country, and I feel scared to use the word, the nation hasn't been told, but the country has not actually been told what the picture was. It was only after that clash in which Indian soldiers died, and we don't yet know exactly what the casualties on the Chinese side were, that people were actually beginning to say things. Now, you look a month later, and what is official, you know, it's still very source-based about the exact positions. But what are we essentially saying? We're saying the Chinese have pulled back. Now, why would the Chinese pull back mean anything to us unless Chinese had transgressed? Unless they were in places where they shouldn't
be. So basically
you're
saying the government can't have it both ways. If what they were saying in May was true, then what they're saying today kind of contradicts that position.
I basically go with what Anand said earlier about Iran as well, which is that, you know, the government needs to feel that they need to tell people about these things, you know, and it's not something that, this is all national security and we can't really disclose anything. Eventually, if things are going to come out, the government has to be much clearer about what its position is, what is China's position. Are we creating, for example, buffer zones at the LAC? We've never had these before. Are we now going to create these? Are we pulling back ourselves, as you said, to places that we used to patrol in the past and we're not patrolling now, like things that are called like Patrol Point 14 or Finger 4, as they say? Are we now pulling back? Is that pullback permanent or is it temporary? These are things I think the government does need to engage with, because, you know, in front of this country is a huge example of 1962 and the idea that from 1959 to 1962, Prime Minister Nehru really did not give the country the full picture of what was happening. That's why surprises happen, nasty surprises happen. And that's why we are supposed to be different from China, that we're a democracy where these things are, you know, people are brought into confidence on some issues. Here we have a situation where if you put out a story, more time is spent in trying to discredit you than is in looking at the story and saying, excuse me, is this story correct or not?
Right.
I see this happening on a daily basis, that all kinds of, you know, sort of clarifications and every kind of government response doesn't actually deal with the facts of a story. They all deal with what's wrong with the person putting story out.
I'd say before one points fingers at the government, one would just have to point fingers at one's own fraternity, that the journalists don't even ask the questions. While I think newspapers and print journalism still has the credibility that news should have, the impact is great in prime time. I mean, for good or bad. And there you don't see the guys even ask the questions. That's tragic.
Absolutely. I mean, I'm referring just to what Anand said, which is that, you know, that that people come out saying, the report against on India being dropped from the Iranian railway line is false. That's the easy thing to say. What exactly is Iran saying? Iran is saying, no, India was never a part of the deal. I think we should be worried about that. I think other journalists should go and ask those questions. Instead, it's just about, no, I'm sorry, this report was inconvenient. Let's forget it. Let's move on. That's what's happened with so many of the journalists talking about China.
I think even on the Sachin story, that is, and we'll discuss that going forward. But just one more foreign policy issue before I just open it to something that I would like the whole panel to weigh in on. You know, quickly, Sasani, I think 2 or 3 years ago, I had read this piece on this One Road, One Belt, Orop tha na, inka jo China ka tha.
Right.
Which was supposed to go right across Pakistan, Afghanistan, whatever, Istan. And I had read a piece, actually, this was, I think, an NPR, that the next Lehman crisis could be triggered in China because the kind of high-risk zones where this Orop or One Road, One Belt is passing through, some of these places are Taliban controlled. Some of these places are completely tribal areas of Pakistan where no government has any influence. So, China can't buy their silence, although it's trying. And I think there was a couple of Chinese banks that were leveraged to like $50 billion, $60 billion to make this happen. And if that project fell, they'd say the Lehman equivalent would start in China. Now, I know that The Economist has in the past, The Time Magazine has in the past, tried to discredit China's economy as early as, you know, 2000, 2001. There are bigger things involved. But where is that One Road, One Belt? I don't read much about it. Is it going as per plan? Are the banks who are financing it robust? Is it going to change the entire economic situation and make China the driver of much of the non-US area, of not anything other than the Americas?
I'm sure Anand wants to weigh in on this as well. China's Belt and Road Initiative is clearly what some people would say is biting off more than China could chew. Such an ambitious plan at a time when the world was actually shrinking, the economy was actually shrinking around the world. But they did get about 60 odd countries on board with that plan. And they have been able to at least start projects in various places. Now, obviously, one of the problems is going to be funding. And you're right that many of the projects, the money has not come through. I'll give you the example of Iran again. The deal that China is apparently renegotiating with Tehran is for a $400 billion 25-year strategic partnership deal. This will include infrastructure projects, oil projects, as well as banking, commercial interests, and all the rest of that. Now, $400 billion may not seem a large amount if you're just talking about China's investment in one country. But then think about it, if they are doing that with 30, 40 other countries, then at some point, China is going to have to get a return on this investment. At present, what we've seen is China's lines of connectivity are essentially about securing oil resources, energy resources, and of exporting Chinese goods to the rest of the world. We're not yet seeing the other part of the trade, people being able to export goods to China, for example. I always give this example because I saw this with my own eyes in one dry dock in Xinjiang province, where there was an entire train of ketchup being shipped from China, not shipped, but by train.
Ketchup as in sauce.
Tomato ketchup. Achcha, or tomato, okay. Tomato puree, tomato sauce, from China to Italy. And this was the first train, going from a place near Urumqi to Naples. Now, when you think about that, China is exporting tomato, so think about it next time you have your pasta, pomodoro, or whatever, to Italy. But what is Italy sending back to China? Not much. So unless you've got a full trade cycle going, this is going to be a very unequal relationship. Eventually, it will not hold. As far as China's investments go, look at the case with Pakistan, the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, where billions of dollars have already come in, certainly not as much as China had promised to start with. And at some point, these billions of dollars are going to have to give China a little more than the comfort of having, got one more friend. They are going to have to pay back. And when they don't, when they're not able to pay back, you see the situation in Sri Lanka, where eventually, right, according to the deal, Sri Lanka had to hand over a port to Chinese control because they couldn't pay back the loans. So this is why the Chinese Belt and Road Initiative is of concern to the rest of the world. But it's also, eventually, you're quite right, will be of concern to China itself.
Anand, do you want to weigh in on this? One road, one belt, is it potentially the next Lehman trigger that will make Chinese banks collapse? Or will it go through? Or will some person blow it up somewhere in the middle?
I think the financial aspects of it, Swasni has explained, that it at some point it has to be a two-way traffic. If it doesn't, then it would unleash its own set of anxieties. That is one part. Lehman, that is still speculative whether it would happen or not. But just briefly, I think one of the ways of seeing it built and this road initiative is also that the Middle Kingdom philosophy, if say of greater influence over the world. Now, if in 2020 it is trying to replicate, say, in the post Second World War, say, the both camps, Warsaw or NATO, or some kind of broad alliance of nations, say, glued together with a certain kind of military philosophy or a security philosophy or something. But that was backed by some kind of military strength swing in real situations. Mind it that China, with all its power, with its all economic muscle, after 1979, when it was part of UN peacekeeping force in Vietnam, has not sowed any direct combat experience on a larger scale. So it has a kind of, say, a deficit in real military exercise, in real situations. That has its own military anxieties. And the only lever through which it is pushing its, say, hegemonic designs is through its economic larger kind of alliance and its muscle showing and through these kind of pacts and alliances. So I think when the combination is not both, with all its string of pearls and this and that and South China Sea aggression, this, I think the lack of real combative show of its strength has to be compensated with other initiatives which are very, very grand, like this Belt and Road and this. If it doesn't succeed, it's a roadblock in its hegemonic designs. And replicating post-Second World War military alliances in 2020 in a different international scenario, I think it would be interesting to see. So we should not have a premature guess about it, but see what happens.
Right. So I'm just going to read out a couple of emails. Thank you for that, guys. I hope our audience is happy with our foreign policy discussion, because they have often asked for specific things to be explained a little more detailed. Now, just to give Anand and Suhasini a context of the emails I'm reading, last week I had commented on something called safetyism. Are you familiar with it? I was made familiar with the concept the week before last, actually.
I'm just getting up to speed with cancel culture. What is safetyism?
Yeah, so safetyism basically is related. It's close. It's the expectation of the millennial to be in an environment. To be in an environment where nothing that is said should, quote unquote, trigger them. They should not have to listen to anything that is unpleasant. Maybe I'm saying this from the Gen X uncle point of view, but basically that anything can be called triggering or toxic. And because of that, a cancel culture is one of the fallouts of that. And it's this safetyism, while the millennial thinks he or she is standing up for liberal values, it is exactly the antithesis of liberal values, of not wanting to even be exposed to ideas that could, again, quote unquote, trigger you or make you feel that you're in a toxic environment. So based on that, I've got a bunch of mails. I'm just going to read them out. And then I just like, you know, the panel's views on this, because last time we just kind of discussed it in passing. So the first email on this is by Uday. Uday says, hello, panel. First of all, I feel proud that I'm supporting such a spirited, accurate and nuanced platform of discussion as Hafta. After seeing many American outlets like Vox, CNN caving in, I was heartened that Abhinandan and co stood up for classic liberal values and upheld the ethos of freedom of speech. Since he often feels anxious about his views make him sound like an uncle, I'd like to reassure Abhinandan that he sounds nothing but a reasonable person who favors a society supporting an open exchange of ideas without malice, and where mere thoughts don't count as egregious, injustice or violence. As someone more than 20 years younger than him, I'd like to say that there are enough among my friends who disagree on many things, but also hold the spirit of free discussion itself as a value that all of us should aspire to, and thus support Harper's letter. Hashtag not all millennials. If believing in such rational and universal values makes one an uncle, then so fucking be it, because I'm tired of too much equivocation and if-buttish hush-hushing around the issue. A bouquet from my generation to his. As a fellow fan of Rushdie, I was surprised Abhinandan didn't mention him as one of the signatories of the letter too. I wrote in to dispel three crucial things that critics of the letter allege, since I've got a bad feeling that someone else will write to you bringing about these very points against the letter. One, it's not about whether free speech is absolute or not. Nowhere does the letter mention that free speech means the right to call the N-word or casteist slurs. The letter was not debating if free speech is absolute or not, which would take a long time to settle, and nor did it say that the speech itself was above critique and those objecting to it oppose free speech. It was rather a way of a certain mood of taboo and silence setting in whenever things got morally complicated. And most importantly, that people were either losing their jobs or their positions were made suspect simply because they chose to espouse rather than anodyne opinions. Two, the signees are not all elite white men. They include Iranian women, professors who escaped from the Iranian Khomeini revolution, black women, women like Anne Applebaum and Gloria Steinem, Asian journalist Li Fang, who was nearly fired for being racist.
Yeah, that case was really bizarre.
And arguably the greatest novelist India has produced, which I'm guessing you're talking about Rushdie. The letter was in fact started by a black columnist named Thomas Chatterton Williams, who was also targeted on Twitter for betrayal. I think the thing which really spooked the neoliberal woke police was the realization that not all white people think alike, that they have individual agency to think for themselves, and they can't be constrained to their group identity like herd of sheep. The horror of individuality. Three, ideas are not violence, and there should be no ideological safe space. In campuses of especially private universities, this dangerous concept of safetyism is spreading. I work in one, so I speak from experience. A trans Vox employee complained on Twitter that her colleague signing the letter made her feel unsafe, and some even had the chutzpah to say that no signee had undergone anything like censorship or violence. Forgetting Rushdie, Garry Kasparov, and many others who had not only been censored but exiled, jailed, or threatened. Such warped ideas about what violence is amuses me. Even if Rowling's ideas are reprehensible, the best way to defang them is to show their ridiculousness out in the open. This issue would have been long over if someone were to just to fact-check her writing and dismantle each of her arguments. I thought Manisha, Mehraj and Ramansar navigated the issue very reasonably and responsibly. Since Mehraj and Manisha had recommended Matt Taibbi earlier, I'd also suggest his latest piece on this letter to you and all listeners. Also linking here an essential understanding of free speech by Noam Chomsky himself, which has been doing the rounds. So this is Uday's view. I just have one more email to read and then I would like to get the panel's view. This view is not similar to Uday's. This is Vaibhav. Vaibhav says, way to kick the hornet's nest, you guys. I'm sure you will receive a ton of emails and pro and against your views. So I'll try to keep mine brief. I will keep and break it down into 3 points. One, cancel culture is not a new phenomenon. For generations, people have been canceling and shaming people on the margins of society. For example, let us consider America in the 19th century. When Jim Crow was the law of the land, black people protesting for equal rights were shunned. At the same time, white people who worked for civil rights faced boycotts of their businesses, as seen here. And there is a link to a piece on PBS. Then the Sovereignty Commission contributed funds to the citizen councils and formed a covert network that tracked blacks and whites. Blacks in favor of integration or seen trying to register black voters would lose their jobs, their homes, even their lives. White businessmen would face boycotts and politicians would lose votes if they were believed to be sympathetic to African Americans' efforts at integration. Two, who gets cancelled? In the past, the existing power structure suppressed and intimidated people who were trying to speak for the oppressed. Right now, that has reversed. Those who oppose the fundamental right of people are facing a backlash by those who have gained rights. Thanks to social media, it is much easier to point out hatred and correct it. Three, J.K. Rowling. So I was puzzled by your painting of Rowling as a victim being quieted for expressing an opinion. The problem is, this was not her first time. She has consistently been showing transphobic views and has been allowed to correct the record. She had a chance to learn and she has decided not to take it. She funds campaigns that are hurtful to people. Her latest diatribe about trans people would be the last straw and has led many people to demand she not be patronized. Money paid to her goes to causes that harm people. In that case, why shouldn't people boycott her? Lastly, you mentioned ideas should be entertained and left to the marketplace of ideas. Are bhai, what is defeat and commonplace of ideas? Do we just keep listening to them again and again? Or do we say ki ho gaya bas karo ab? If they don't change, learn. Do we ignore them or let them face an economic backlash? Boycott of J.K. Rowling is the freest form of expression and an example of the marketplace of ideas deciding a winner. Because free speech does not mean you get to say whatever you like without retribution. All it means is you can say whatever you like and the government can not take action against you solely for speaking out. You can yell blacks who date whites must be lynched and the government can't touch you. Again, a link has been provided to an ACLU piece. Can you be fired from your cushy job or have your books boycotted? Yell. Hell yeah. That's it for now. I can obviously go on and on. I purposely chose Western examples because cancel culture and free speech have only truly taken hold in more developed economies, democracies. India has not really cancelled anyone for Islamophobia or casteist bigotry, nor do we have free speech. This issue is not really important in India. Note, trigger warnings is something completely different and not related to cancel culture. Asking you to be sensitive about minorities in the workplace or public is a reflection of increased sensitivities. For example, would it be appropriate for you to joke about rape when someone around you has been raped? Pay note about Washington being judged too harshly, saying that values were different back then is not right. His colleges were abolitionists. The reason him and many others engaged in human trafficking were economic, Maybe if cancel culture had existed back then, slavery would have been abolished earlier. P.S. The anger and agitation Abhinandan, when he talked about soft millennials being squishy and sensitive, was quite something. It was almost like he was, what's the word, triggered. So, Vaibhav, thank you for it. I've received many other mails on this, which I shall read a little later. Maybe we'll publish some of them because they have been very well articulated. Hey, Vaibhav, I'm not triggered. I'm happy to discuss this. I'd like people to talk about this all the time. I won't tell you not to say this because it triggers me. I love being triggered. I will not say, oh, this upsets me, so don't say it. Fuck, say it. It upsets me. Upset me. I love being upset. And cancel culture and this whole trigger thing, I think, are related. They are not the same thing. I agree.
Also, I mean, he's making a bit of an exaggeration. A, rape jokes are not something you go around cracking. It's not like I'll say, hey, what's the new rape joke you have for me today? Mm. So anyway, it's not something. We have come to an understanding that certain jokes are crass. I'd say even like, I find wife jokes really irritating sometimes when old men. I just find them irritating. But it's different from saying that, say I have a colleague who's Muslim or I have a colleague who's upper caste, I have a colleague who's Buddhist and I can't challenge, you know, questions about their religion or... Or for example, Me Too, if you were to take the gender spectrum, then in Me Too, during the time of Me Too in 2018, it had become, and you saw this in a lot of newsrooms, including ours, that the dictum that believe her had become so strong that anyone who had even a smallest of question or query or skepticism about a case was just like, oh, you Tavleen Singh. Hmm. Tavleen Singh was also, she'd become the epitome of, you know. Hmm. So that is what I meant with when it came to trigger warning or reporting on stuff.
Sure.
I mean, of course, we know that. I mean, none of us want to crack rape jokes, anyways. Of course, it's not like.
No, I mean, those who advocate for free speech.
Yeah.
I don't think they talk about it in absolute terms.
The issue here is more challenging the beliefs that you hold.
Yeah.
You know, my belief in Me Too or my belief in a particular kind of a philosophy.
So, yeah, Mehraj, you want to come in on that? I mean, and I just like to say, Vaibhav, it was a little more nuanced. One is not saying that one can say this, so therefore one should be allowed to say this. One can. Say that, sure, rape jokes are offensive, and I think we've moved way beyond that. But I think the equivalence you draw, and this is the biggest flaw in your thesis, a rape joke is the same as me saying that I don't get the gender fluidity thing, that today I feel like a woman and tomorrow I feel like a man. I don't get it. I get a rape, that, you know, what rape is.
So one important point that was pointed out is this lack of perspective. So when we talk about these things, people like us, I mean, privileged people who have a voice, who have a platform to voice our views. So when we talk about these things, we kind of tend to like narrow our gaze and just forget what is happening elsewhere. So this insistent focus on cancel culture, there's this writer who has the New York Times open to him, he can write, and then somebody says something to him and he's triggered or whatever. In this country, like Weber also pointed out, just this, are you talking about safetyism, for example, on campus? Just this week, there was this story from UP where in a residential school, minor boys were raped by the teachers. And they have to suffer, they still are in that school because their parents back in Assam are too poor to come and take them home right now.
Hmm.
So those, we shouldn't lose perspectives of things. When we are talking about this person doesn't have absolute free speech and he's trying to insult somebody and we're getting triggered by it. Those are important debates, no less. But this perspective is important. When in a country, for example, in India, try talking about Kashmir in a way that doesn't conform to the majority opinion or the government's opinion. Try talking about army. In this country, journalists have been killed, jailed. Right now, journalists are being like questioned and jailed and everything. So when we are talking about these things, we should have this perspective in mind. These are important debates, but this is also there. So this isn't just somebody wrote a racist creed in a newspaper and he's being cancelled. Yes, of course. Do that.
Sure, absolutely.
Agitate against that.
Yeah.
But make sure that the foundations, I mean, if the foundations are this rotten, then you, some privileged person who writes an opinion piece in a newspaper, and then you get the whole discussion is about that. Hmm. That kind of defeats the purpose.
But then, Mehra, don't you think they're two different things? Because in India, there'll always be someone worse off than you, always be someone who's going through hell, not in the same way as you are. But that can't mean that I can't talk about issues which are privileged.
No, of course, they're important.
I mean,
like I said,
there will always be terrible.
They're important. That's what I started saying. They are important, but that those shouldn't overshadow the more real problems there are.
I just think they're different problems. I don't know real and unreal because, of course, when I look at the broader thing, cancel culture is really minuscule.
I think it's more a trend thing. Sorry, sir, go ahead.
No, I said one problem does not make another bigger or lesser.
Not at all. See,
and the problems
this
are problems.
This is how privilege works. For example, we did this story about this UP has been going after journalists like left, right and center. The only time there was outrage was when they went after Siddharth Varadarajan or Supriya Sharma.
Yeah.
More journalists, local journalists, have had to face worse.
But that's something we pointed out at, I think, every Media Rumble. But I mean, what I'm saying is that I don't think it's okay, but it's an inevitability. I think that I personally don't like spending too much time discussing inevitabilities because, and that's not true, a minor disagreement, Manisha, it's not true for India that there'll always be someone worse off. It's true for anywhere in the world. It's true for Norway and Austria also. Like today I was seeing in the BBC Bulletin in the morning, Austria, this guy who's contesting whatever, prime minister, hota hai, president, hota hai, pata nahi kya hota hai unka. Kya hota hai, Suhasini, Austria mein?
Chancellor.
I think it's the
Chancellor. So the person who's contesting is basically saying that we are paying too much for,
migrants,
or we have to get something back. So there's a divide in Austria on that. And one of the person, in fact, she was a makeup artist. She says, we are such a rich country. You know, I don't know why we are making such a big deal about if we have to contribute a little more to EU. So what I'm saying is even in Austria, there's someone who's worse off than you because the person saying that I'm a farmer, I'm struggling, COVID has ruined my crop. Now, that farmer is probably living a life better than me. But I'm saying that is true for any country. But
just to add the Google alert, it's the president.
It's the president. Anyone. Okay. So on this whole, now I guess you get an idea of what our discussion was last time and the various people weighing in on this. You want to comment on this? And just one more mail I've got. I'm not reading the whole mail. This person is mail saying that, you know, she is maybe not my and Suhasini's generation. Maybe she's Mehraj and Manisha's generation. She was saying, I have a problem with people who are reporting to me. Someone wanted to take a day off after Sushant Singh Rajput died. So I was like, why? She says, no, I just want to deal with that. So she says, I couldn't say no because, you know, you're scared. Ki sala. She says, did you know him? No, I didn't know him. He was a star to me, but it has triggered me. So I need to take a day off to deal with
it. But is she dealing with some sort of depression?
I don't know. But the point is that's the fact that she didn't have the guts to say no. Like, what the fuck do you need a day off? I mean, you don't even know this guy. But you can't say that because today the expectation is that I can get triggered because of something I see. So I think that's a different thing from a rape joke. And this is something that, honestly, I am having a problem dealing with. I don't understand it.
You know, the truth is that we are living in a world where your personal and your professional and your societal views are all out there in the open. They have more platforms than ever before. So one of the things we need to do is, you know, I don't know if it's possible to decouple, but to understand that essentially a lot of the things that you just mentioned that people have a problem with or people don't have a problem with are interpersonal relationships. After all, if this boss has a problem with the employee taking a day off, would it be possible to relook at whether that's something that needs to be decided between within organizations without this necessarily being a public debate? There are some organizations, for example, who will give you paternal leave, some who will give you less or will be more understanding or less understanding, because of course there are laws about these things. Similarly, when it comes to the more serious issue, if you ask me, of criminality, when someone threatens criminality, threatens rape, threatens murder, the truth is that we do have to look at it in a much more clinical manner than we do right now. What ends up happening is somebody says something, the reaction to that becomes 2,000 times something. And then what ends up happening is then there is a backlash to that backlash. Eventually, the two people who are, you know, arguing about this are the two people who are essentially removed from the actual debate. I think what happened with this particular rape case, for example, or the rape threat, alleged rape threat, because now we have the apology that says, I said rape, but I didn't mean it, is essentially the person who was given the threat went to the police. Police took action. I think we need to look at it as facts. This is what happened. If we make everything into an issue about, you know, and eventually it just becomes reductive because it ends up being you're liberal, you're right wing, you're left wing, and then the debate has nothing to do with the actual fact. But if you keep going back to the original debate and say, is this an interpersonal relationship? Is this something that needs to be discussed at an organizational level? And then is it something that we need to decide at a societal level? I think all of these lines have gotten mixed up essentially because of social media and where it's going. And eventually, I think we are going to have to maybe work new compacts, i.e. you do not say things that are, you know, just the way you look at a social media, a social platform like, say, Twitter. They have new rules, right? Where they say, we will not accept a comment that says this, this, or this. Is this not,
right.
Is this aimed at a community? Everybody has to make those rules. You make those rules personally, and you make those rules societally. I think what's actually lost, if you like, and this is now, I don't want to come into this argument with my own rant, but I think what's getting really lost is the ability to engage. I'm not right. even saying that there should be a middle ground, because some things are just right and wrong.
Yes.
I'm saying that the ability to engage without this necessarily becoming, you know, a three-generational war, that's getting lost in every one of these debates. Just like the debate you right now had, whether that person should have been given leave because she was so distraught about something that had happened to someone she didn't even know or not, is the factor of a debate. I mean, how many personal days does she have? What is the company's policy on these things? These things can actually be discussed. They don't have to be reduced to essentially, you know, my way or nothing.
Okay. Anand, I'll just come to you. Raman had something to add.
I mean, you gave one instance of this girl who got affected. In fact, I know people who have got affected and who had no idea of, they had not even seen his movies. Like my son, he lives in Boston. And for next 2 weeks, he did nothing but watching his interviews, all of his interviews. And he was discussing his interview, how intelligent he was. And
that,
how,
even I did. But I mean, I didn't need a holiday for it. Like, I didn't need time from work to do it.
So I mean, at one point I said, why you have to concentrate so much?
I mean, being affected is different. Like, I liked Saroj Khan, but until she died, I didn't bother seeing a documentary on her. Once I saw the documentary on her, my respect for her went up and her death became more tragic.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a different thing. Anand, you want to come in on this whole safetyism as an illiberal concept, or is it consistent with liberal values?
Okay, just two brief points on this cancel culture and what you call safetyism. First, it is amusing because with the short life we have, people so sure of what is purpose of life and what we should be doing and not doing, it is really amusing that if I say so, my life is meaningless. If someone said this, it is meaningful. So as if being something is the sole purpose of something. People are not like that. So that is why, as someone said, that cancel culture would be just a fad. It would be a kind of, a culture of a few, because most of the people are essentially private people. They are not very public spirited. Though for a living I write on public issues and public affairs, I am essentially not very interested in public affairs, not public issues. I'm not interested. And most of the people are like this, who are not interested. They have some views, they have something. And that is also my problem with saying something as love and hate, because these are very stark words and they give you a kind of moral unassailability if you accuse someone of hate. Okay, because these are very identifiable words. Even say someone not so well educated knows what means, he has imbibed what hate means, what love means. More synonymous words with less, even if they have more impact, like say bile, malice, or say a kind of spite. Now that would be the thing, but this morally unassailable concepts like love, hate, and cancel him, cancel that, he should not be allowed, he should be allowed, it gives a kind, it's a very arrogant kind of air to things. Second thing is, that there is also this kind of, you say, simple templates applied. I mean, someone writing on India from very far away in, say, Europe or America now, he writes with certain templates of, say, like, this is discrimination, this is not, this is the decisive factor. And when I see their Indians far away in, say, in Delhi, Mumbai, writing on some remote places in India about an event, the templates are same of, say, one of the factors being the overriding factor, say caste, community, or some kind of this and that. But as Suhasini was pointing out, the ground situation may be more complex. That would be one of the factors, but not overriding factor, or may not be even an important factor in a particular situation. So you need to be more patient with facts, more patient with the actual issue at hand, and not be very lazy with applying templates. That's it.
Just to add to Anand's point about this templates, that's a very important point. This is a tendency that we use these, for example, cancel culture. This debate is happening in a particular context, American context, Western context. Then we transpose it to, say, Indian context without looking at the context we are talking about this. That becomes problematic. Similar thing happened, say, for example, when those statues were pulled down. The power dynamic, what the power dynamic is there, we talk about it in Indian context without looking at the power dynamic. For example, there, the demand to pull down the statues is from people who were oppressed, who are now trying to gain power, and they're against people who have always had power and they're trying to bring equality. In Indian context, for example, if the same thing, say, for example, the Babri Masjid, the people who pulled it down are the people who already have the power against people who don't have the power. So that's a completely different context. These, when we talk about in these journal terms, like Anand said, use these same templates for every context, and that then we land up in problems, and then we just mess up everything.
I just want to add that I think Sabrimala case could be a good way of understanding the cancel culture phenomena. Here's a case that I at least wasn't sure whether the Supreme Court should have interfered or not. And when you're a writer or a journalist in a public life, there are two things that cancel culture can do. That this is not a black and white issue, right? I could think that Supreme Court shouldn't have interfered, and maybe this is something that people have to decide for themselves. But I would not fear saying that, because I'd be immediately dubbed as an anti-feminist or as a backward person or this upper caste, you know, perpetuator of tyranny. So that, and I think the other aspect in cancel culture is this applause group. And for better or for worse, we are on Twitter and social media, and a lot of our worth today, we judge by how many people share our pieces, how many people praise us on Twitter. I think one of the finest pieces that Mihir Sharma wrote on was on Sabrimala, against the judgment. Not against the judgment, but he was arguing the same point that maybe the court shouldn't have interfered. Now, that piece barely got any traction versus a piece where he'd probably talk about Modi and how terrible he is.
Because
so I think what
his grouping expects
exactly.
him to.
So the problem with cancel culture also is that then it kills innovative thought. It kills a writer's, it kills this aspect in a writer where you want to go beyond what's already being said to say something new, for fear of upsetting someone. So I think those are the two important aspects of cancel culture. A, being put in a bracket that I don't want to be seen as an anti-feminist.
Right.
But I'll be scared of saying something that, because I think, oh shit, five of my peers would think I'm not a feminist.
And also the pressure of having to weigh in on something that you really don't really have a view on. That you have to have a view on something.
But that I have given up on. I mean, at least I think, and I think a lot of journalists should do that also. And it's quite remarkable that Suhasini also said that in the beginning, that I only weigh in on foreign policy issues. I really think more and more journalists should just not feel the pressure to weigh in on everything and just talk about what you know about. That's a really good habit.
Okay.
And it puts you in less trouble.
In the time of social media, I don't think that's possible.
Yeah.
But also one important point, one great danger of this trend, of this cancel culture, is that over time you become self-censoring. And there is no greater
danger
threat
than
to
that.
Free thought than self-censorship.
Yeah. True. Yeah. It changes behavior. Suhasini, Anand, you want to come in on this? I have a couple of emails and Suhasini has to leave us. I know she won't want to weigh in on Sachin and other such. So she might want to leave us with a couple of recommendations. Suhasini, what do you have for us? Do you want to weigh in on Sachin, by the way, before I assume? Why should I censor your thought?
To the point that I've already said, I think we need to just look at the facts and allow facts to play out. We seem to already have labeled, and the amount of labeling that is going on in terms of, if you support one side, then you're a dynast. If you support the other side, you're not just a dynast, you're a Lutyens liberal, you're an English speaker, you're a Hindi speaker, you're good looking, you're not good looking. I mean, the way this essentially in-party political crisis has become something that defines the person having an opinion about it, is really, I mean, it's something we all need to take a step back from. But honestly, I completely back up what I said earlier, which is that if I don't really know something about it, I think best to leave my opinions out of it. In terms of recommendations, I just say that, you know, the last few months with as far as India and China are concerned, and even now with Iran, what ends up happening is we are now looking at foreign policy just as an event-driven exercise. And so my recommendation is it's necessary to go back and read. There are so many books on India and China that you could read, which are not just about India-China, but, you know, triangular exercises. So there are two books that are specifically about India-China and the US, one by a journalist called Martin Seifer, another by Tanvi Madan, who's in Washington, and has written an excellent book about in India-China and the US's relationships. And last recommendation for a book is something by Ambassador P. Sobdan on the Great Game in the Buddhist Himalayas, because so much of this is linked not just to the international world, but to the countries that countries and states that are on the actual periphery between India and China. So it's about Ladakh, it's about Sikkim, it's about Bhutan, it's about Arunachal Pradesh and Nepal. All of these have come into focus because of the India-China situation. So those are my recommendations.
Thank you so much, Suhasini. We've kept you for longer than we had
always
promised.
Always a pleasure, Abhinandan. Thanks so much. And thanks so much for inviting me to discuss these issues, which, as you said, sometimes get put by the wayside with all the politics of the day.
Our pleasure. And I'm sure our subscribers will be thrilled. So guys, see, we get you such amazing guests. Keep on the love and the subscription that you send us, even though the Hafta is not behind the paywall for the next 4 weeks. Okay, thanks, Asini. Have a good weekend. Yeah.
Yep, you too.
Before I continue on to Sachin, I had another two mails. Can I just request my producer, Aditya, all the safeties and mails, let's just publish them as one piece this week, because they are all so well articulated, even the ones that agree with me and disagree. I mean, I think all of them have made some, I think on one page, let's just have on one page, people can read them all together. Now, this one is a way more nuanced one. And although, Manjari, you have said, I'll read what you've said. You said, I'd appreciate you reading the letter yourself. I don't mind if you don't read it out on next Hafta. So I guess that means that you don't mind if I do either, right?
Yeah.
So it's not like I'm breaching a trust by reading out her mail.
Look at you being so cautious. I thought you didn't care.
No, I just want to be...
No, I think she's... I mean,
so it says, I don't mind if you don't read it out.
So that's fine.
So that's fine. So Manjari has actually, I think, kind of put a way more nuanced position than the earlier two mails. Hi, I'm writing to commend you on your free speech discussion last Hafta. I felt that nuanced arguments were made and admire how Abhinandan has shown an open mind exploring ideas and changing his opinions in some instances. I totally agree that a society needs to allow robust debate and multiple perspectives, but I'm wondering if snowflakes / safetyism / cancel culture quote unquote trends actually exist. I defined that these trends exist if they are being practiced by a not insignificant minority and which are a bigger proportion of the population than previous generations, which is what I think Mehraj is saying. I'm not convinced yet because, one, India and US/UK are very different cultures at different stages in their cultural evolution, but linked by Twitter. I don't think both could be at the same point on cancel culture. I don't see any proof that millennials and Gen Z are specifically soft. This sounds like a right-wing theory to complain when told not to be racist or sexist. Two, merely replying with energy isn't cancel culture. Neither is it cancel culture for Harry Potter fan sites to say they won't link to Rowling's website, so won't promote her personally, only her work. She is saying what she wants. They are saying that they don't agree. I think that qualifies as free speech. People losing their jobs, say for a tweet expressing, could qualify. How many such cases are there? Are there enough to form a culture? Is it also cancel culture to advise people to not watch TV news when people are ostracized by fellow villagers, like when an ancestor of mine was when he decided to educate his daughters? If people refuse to discuss a reasonable subject without reason, I call it stupid culture, and that isn't new. Also, I'm rereading Annihilation of Caste. I smell some parallels with how caste is ignored by upper castes and how white people don't want to discuss racism as discussed in White Fragility video. I'd recommend the video to Mehraj.
Oh, thank you.
So Manjari, I thought she made some very, very valid points, which is, for me at least, hard to disagree with. There is one more email on this cancel culture, which is also very articulate. I don't know whether I'm going over the top on emails, but there's, I just think that they may have smarter things to say than us. So, I don't know. No disrespect to my panel. But I just like to read one more, then I'd get back to the panel. There's one mail specifically for Anand, which I'll give Anand all the time in the world to. Anand, I haven't read the full her counter to your piece. I hope you have.
Yes, I have. I'll
just come to that. There was just one more email on cancel culture before we come to that. So this email is from Dheeraj. I guess your safetyism discussion with my email had me want to put one more point in. Disclaimer, I'm not a parent. The point is, simply look at how kids are being parented now and before. Me as a kid did not have me messaging my mom that I am safe every hour or so. It's not really just one gender. It's like across genders these days. Tech allows you to see where they are almost every millisecond. Point being, if kids are put into an incredibly safe space, don't do this and that, it's a no-brainer. They are going to live in a bubble where anything they deem unsafe is not worth hearing. To make an absolutely crude comment, the umbilical cord is never really cut. Metaphorically, the cord is the safety. It's quite obvious where the safetyism culture comes from. Gen X, Y millennial parenting. So it's the parenting that's at fault is what Dheeraj is saying. Now, I know if you end up reading this on Hafta, beware, you're going to get a lot of flack from parents for allowing this view from a non-parent. What experience do I have? Something like this Russell Peters skit, somebody gonna get hurt real bad. So that's Dheeraj weighing in. We have a couple others. So we'll be publishing all the safetyism mails as one mail.
So what we can do is when we publish the Hafta letters on this thing, we'll bunch all these together and then we'll publish the rest of them.
Yes. Yeah, let's do that.
Or maybe you can put it up separately, no? On a separate post.
Or we can, or separate safetyism, like, you know? Safetyism.
Yeah, we can do that.
News Laundry subscribers weigh in on safetyism. I think we can. And we can link the Hafta to that.
All right. Mm.
So I'll just first get to Sachin Pilot. Then we'll come to Anand's mail. Because let's just break the mail. So context, those of you who've been living under a rock, Sachin Pilot suddenly went incognito. There were all sorts of rumblings that he's going to leave the party. He'll topple the Rajasthan government. He had claimed he has 30 MLAs, apparently he has 15-20. Even as of now, he doesn't have the numbers to take down the government.
Or to bargain a CM post for himself.
Or bargain a CM post, which has been outright rejected. Mr. Chief Minister came and said this.
This new generation has come, we love them. आने वाला कल उनका है, देश का फ्यूचर इन पे डिपेंड करता है। अगर ये खुद ही हॉर्स ट्रेडिंग को पसंद करेंगे, हॉर्स ट्रेडिंग को प्रमोट करेंगे, हॉर्स ट्रेडिंग का हिस्सा बनेंगे, ये नई पीढ़ी के लोग, तो देश को बर्बाद नहीं करेंगे क्या? अच्छा इंग्लिश हिंदी बोलना, अच्छी बाइट देना, वो सब कुछ नहीं होता।
Meanwhile, Sachin said nothing because I think he was supposed to have a press conference, but he realized he doesn't have numbers, he'll have egg on his face. Now there's this joke that's going around on Twitter that sources say that Sachin likes Kanda and Rahul likes Adrak or whatever. It's become this joke ki sources se sab kuch bhi pel rahe hain. So for 2 days, this was like 24-hour coverage.
For the first time, we had something besides China or coronavirus.
Yes.
And it was Congress mega failure hit being a party.
So now this has led to, you know, what we were discussing, that people have to win. Either you're on Sachin, Team Sachin or Team Gehlot. And if you criticize Sachin, you're assumed a Team Gehlot. If you criticize Gehlot, you're assumed a Team Sachin. And journalists, like Manisha said, are weighing in too heavily on one side. That's the context. Now, let me start with Anand. Anand, are you Team Sachin? Because you are young and dynamic. Or are you on the old side like us?
Young and restless.
Do you want to weigh in on this? How does this amuse you? Because I suspect it does.
My feeling is that this is a crisis triggered not by Sachin, but by Ashok Gehlot. And I may be speculating, but I think he wants to get him out of the way. And in the recent Raj Sabha elections, he had pretext to do so. And get out of the way in the sense that he wants the succession story to begin in Rajasthan Congress. And discrediting Sachin in eyes of the, say, the dynasts Ten Janpat.
Sorry, just to come in context of what Anand is saying, in a public speech, Mr. Gehlot had accused Sachin of ensuring his son's defeat in the Lok Sabha. Yeah, carry on, Anand.
Yes. So midway, it is he is confident of his numbers, and he. My feeling is that he triggered this crisis. Sachin Gehlot would have timed it a little differently if it was his trigger.
Sachin aur Pilot ki shaadi kara di. Sorry, Gehlot, aapne Sachin Gehlot bol diya. Itna bhi yaarana kya yaar? You mean Sachin Pilot?
Okay. Okay, Sachin Pilot. Now, Congress now looks more like that old man in a family who is dreaded not for how dangerous it is he is now, but how dangerous it was once. So, because you see, unlike the old man in a family in a corner, there is nothing called terminal decline in electoral politics. If you have organization that is few men and women who can work for you, and if you have some money, there is always a road to recovery. And that Congress had around 11 crores 60 lakh votes in last Lok Sabha elections, and that is around 19.6% of votes. And it polled 11 crore votes. If you poll in a general election, you have some means some kind of support base still. So it's not that it is not dangerous. And that's why the BJP has not lost sight of Congress. You cannot lose sight of a political party that has 11 crore votes in the country. And it would be not surprising that after Mr. Gehlot's move, which I speculate it was his move, this crisis, BJP had sent some signals, some Rajasthan-based journalists are writing, that if you can, say, cobble up some numbers, we can do something for you, if not in a frontal mode, then in a supporting role. That has apparently not materialized for Mr. Pilot. Yes. That is what I read. Some bits of it is pure speculation.
Which it always is in these discussions. Raman sir, what is your view? Are you on Team Gehlot or Team Sachin?
No, as Anand said, that Gehlot was the one who triggered it. What I feel that Sachin Pilot is the second generation politician.
Hmm.
His father died, very abruptly. He died in an accident.
Hmm.
And I think he was into his teens, or he was barely out of his teens.
Mm-hmm.
And he really started from the scratch that way, second generation politician. And he worked on the ground and he built up, his career as a politician. Now, in Rajasthan, it is true that the Gehlot was trying to cut him to, his size. So he was promoting a Guzar, netas against him, who can just counter this. His, influence
in the
Gujar community. So, and also he was promoting his own son. So, Gehlot was trying to really cut him to, size. So, but I think for him, whether he had a support of 15 MLAs or 20 MLAs or more than 20, for him, it was very important time to revolt. Because as deputy CM, he was nobody. He was given no portfolios. He was hardly functional. So I think it was for him to revolt. But at this, whether he should go BJP way or Congress way, or the Congress brings him back with a formidable position, he's not sure of that. And BJP naturally they had to jump in, so they are trying to lure him to his to their own side. But I think this juncture at this point, it was very important for Pilot to revolt. And he has done that.
Okay, so you and Anand are very boring, just saying. Did you see that video of people telling Trump, boring, boring, you're so boring. Anyway, so, Mehraj, you spiced it up, man. Team Sachin or Team Pilot. But, Times Now is saying the same thing to us. I have this SMS saved. So Times Now called, sir, will you join us tonight for, this is yesterday. So yesterday I got a call, so we are discussing on Sachin Pilot, will you join 8 prime time? I was like, I don't really have anything of consequence to say to join you on prime time. This, on Sachin, so please come. I said, no. Then today I got a text. So please commit for tonight. We will decide the subject later. So suppose the subject is, I don't know, there's apparently some meteor or comet that's passing the earth. Have you heard? Once in 7,000 years. We should have a party to spot it. It's supposed to be really beautiful. You can see it in time lapse and all. And once in 7,000 years it comes, so it's unlikely we'll see it again. So I haven't responded to that text. Sir, please commit for tonight at 8 o'clock. We'll decide subject later. So what if you talk about
really
that comet?
We have to do a story on
If you talk about that comet, what am I going to say? Should I just say yes and just...
The world is going to end. Let's party.
Okay, forget the panelists. What are these journalists doing? Like Navika and RSS full-time journalists. What do they like? We'll decide in the evening and we'll just like say whatever.
Book kar do. I mean,
why are you encouraging us to take sides?
Sir, I'm doing Rahul Shivshankar, no? That's my job. Yeah, Mehraj, yeah.
So a couple of things that are like really serious and a couple of things that are very amusing. First amusing part is with this whole Sachin Pilot. I mean, this projection, the majority opinion is that Sachin Pilot is somehow deserving of this and he's doing this politics and he's allowed it and he's a victim. Why isn't Ashok Gehlot allowed his politics? I mean, he's also playing politics only, right? I mean, there's no ideological battle here. This guy is looking out for interest. The other guy is also looking for interest. But the other guy is like projected as this oppressor. And this guy, this kid who had everything handed to him on a silver platter practically. And he is like a victim in this. That I find amusing. Second part is, I mean, more serious point is that Congress, as I've said before, is a dying party. But again, amusingly, it is still in the real sense, the only national party in India still. I mean, it's declining fast, but it's a national party. BJP, for all its dominance, it's still only a Hindi heartland party. I mean, you see, for example, in Northeast, as soon as BJP loses power at the center, all those like governments it has in the Northeast are gone, except maybe in Assam. South, except Karnataka, it doesn't have any presence. All the other states also, like say in Punjab and J&K, minimal presence. So Congress still has presence in all those places, though it doesn't amount to much now, so it has that. The most important point aspect in this, which people always tend to agree, is all these political fights are projected, they're written about, they're talked about as these dramas, political dramas, this guy played this game, this guy played this game. What it shows is the utter hollowness of the Indian politics at this point. This is a party, this is a politician who has been railing against BJP all his life because of their ideology. Same with Sindhia and others. And now, tomorrow, he might likely be in the BJP. So what exactly is this?
Please make that clear.
Yes, but I mean, but we never know. Sindhia said the same things. In Bengal, the BJP MLA who was found dead the other day, he was a communist until like a few years ago. And now he's with the BJP. So if this ideology doesn't matter, if what you believe in doesn't matter, if it's all because you'll get this power and that power, what does that say about Indian polity?
Although the case of the clash between the Hindu right and the communists, this was also, I think, kind of when we had Ulekh on our podcast, he's done a lot of... Ulekh is, I think now he's open. He's a very good journalist. He's written a few books, which we have also featured on News Laundry. He said, at least in Kerala, because that's where he's from, it's like belonging to a gang. If you don't belong to a gang and you have some sort of a political activism background, you will die. So suppose you belong to the gang of Al Pacino and you fuck up with some of Al Pacino's men, then you can't say, I'm leaving the gang. They'll kill you. Then you have to go join Al Camino or whatever the fuck it is. So basically the RSS and CPI in Kerala at least are two gangs. So basically I asked him, is like, what kind of a place is this that one day I'm a communist, the other day I'm bloody with the RSS. One day I'm an RSS, the other day I'm... Like, it's not even ki humne dari subtly humne Vishwa Hindus Parishad se Bajrang Dal join kar liya. Hum seedha communist chale gaye. He says, because if you don't belong to one gang, you're fucked.
Yeah, ideological hollowness is the part of Indian political culture for a very long time. Ideological, I mean, if you see the anti-defection law, the way people defect. So I think that is in Rajasthan, I think why Gehlot? Because he is a bigger power elite and he is the one who's controlling the shot and he is trying to,
But he's still the bigger party. I think one thing is, sir, I would disagree with you that he started off from scratch, Sachin. After Rajesh, Rama Pilot was given that seat, she won. She stayed there in Dausa. And then once Sachin was of age, he contested. So that seat never left the family even after Rajesh Pilot
died. And as soon as he reached the age, have you ever heard of any 26-year-old being given
that
a ticket
boy,
anywhere?
That moron from Bangalore who keep that bigoted fool.
The BJP person.
Surya Tejaswi Surya.
Whatever. Yes, Manisha.
So sorry, this thing you are saying about Kerala, it's the same thing with Bengal. I mean, I remember Scroll My Shoaib did the series. So the people who are leaving communists for the BJP, they're leaving because they're afraid of because Trinmul has the power and they're like become this.
You have to belong to a gang, basically.
Yes, but again, I mean, if the only sort of affiliation to a party is because material interests, it's a gang.
Yeah, it's not.
It doesn't have anything. I mean, that's like, if you really think about it, that is what is destroying this country from the inside out.
I mean, I think ideology is also because ideologically, I'm working on a podcast and I've interviewed some 5-6 people. The strongest ideology people will stick to is the RSS, and that's the problem. But you can check that out on the podcast.
Also, again, without, I mean, the usual allegation of bringing caste into everything. All these parties are dominated, and all these people who are going across with parties are dominant caste people. And it doesn't matter much to them. I mean, that
Gujjars aren't dominant in Rajasthan.
Yeah, it's only a little.
In fact,
but Gujjars aren't dominant in Rajasthan.
In Rajasthan, they aren't a dominant caste. Gujjars aren't a dominant caste in Rajasthan.
I'm saying generally in India, I mean, when you, this ideological spectrum from, say, communist to BJP, it's very, very narrow for an upper caste person. It's very narrow. It doesn't make much of a difference.
Narrow, you know, the word narrow always reminds me of Amitabh Bachchan's dialogue. You remember Namak Halal? Bhaira becomes Bhairo and Kara becomes Kano because the mind's very narrow. I know it makes no sense, but I just thought I'd throw it in there. But I have done it's the one interview I have enjoyed most. I will say this, I mean, not one of the, it is an interview I've done which is part of the Let's Talk About RSS, about a young RSS worker who was part of the guys who went and brought down the Babri Masjid. And now he's a activist, Dalit activist, who's hugely against the RSS. And I haven't spoken to such a well-spoken, articulate guy. And basically, I said, what triggered your leaving? He says, because when this whole, after we had, risked our lives, because when we went and brought it down, we could have been buried with the rubble also, And other than that, the police cases and all, there was some RSS thing happening through their village, and he was the village ka in charge. So they came, refreshed themselves in my house, and then they said, hum khayenge nahi, pack kar do, hum raaste mein kha lenge. And when they left, says one of my friends who accompanied them told him they threw it away because they won't eat from your house because you're Dalit. Says that's when I realized that no matter what they say, we are just the cannon fodder for them. It's an amazing interview of that guy. But anyway.
But where is this podcast of yours?
This is like your feminism podcast. Except that I've done 8 interviews. You haven't even done one.
I've done lots. Feminism, nahi, Ramwala.
Ramwala. So my podcast will be out by August.
The people I interviewed must have thought I'm some mole or something. Tell me what you think about Ram and then nothing comes out of it.
Mine will be out in August. Yours we'll see. It's like Mughal Azam.
Ram Nami pe pakka. It'll be out on Ramadan.
Are you team Sachin? Because you're English-speaking urban upper caste.
Are you interviewing
anybody from
Nepal? And I love
Khan Market.
Nepal?
It's my
Sorry,
favorite market. In yeah.
Are you interviewing anybody from Nepal?
I should. Oli ko. I think two things are very amusing. One, no journalist any longer reports on the Congress. Everyone's advising Congress. So even if you look at pieces, you look at reports, this is Rahul Gandhi should have done this. Sachin should have done that. Why didn't Gehlot do this? So in all of this, we just don't know what's happened. It's just advice columns written to the Congress. I hope they read it. There's lots of advice coming their way. To me, what really struck was, we all know that Rajasthan elections was Sachin's MLAs versus Gehlot's MLAs. They were basically fighting the election between each other. And this compromise formula came with Rahul Gandhi coming in. He clicked that famous picture also with that caption, patience and virtue or whatever. With Gehlot and Sachin
that
also.
He did the same thing there.
The same thing.
How unoriginal.
So this was supposed to be a great compromise formula where, Congress will be one happy family and they'll be working together. So the moment when notices go out, no less than sedition as a charge, how is the central leadership in Delhi just silent or letting this happen? I mean, why weren't they saying, like, what is happening in your state? Why are you guys not talking? I mean, clearly this is not something that just one fine day they were slapped with sedition and then, Sachin revolted. So the lack of central leadership is also quite alarming. It's alarming that there's no one in Delhi or no one in the central leadership. Apparently Priyanka Gandhi is making calls. Why? One doesn't know. I mean, she's not elected. She's really a nobody. So to me, I think that's quite alarming. And team Sachin, team Gehlot, I think Gehlot does have the numbers here. So if you purely go by numbers, he just has more MLAs supporting him. So you couldn't have put Sachin.
But do you think that what Gehlot has articulated and many people have agreed with, the fact that Sachin is handsome, speaks good English, the same thing that made Jyotiraditya Scindia so attractive to many people, and I have always maintained he's a duffer from hell. Do you think there is truth in that? Is that why some of the Delhi journalists are so favorable to
No,
him?
I don't think that is the truth. I think Gehlot was playing a politics to kill Sachin forever in his state. So that's what he was trying to do.
And Pilot and Scindia are different. Pilot did work. He was the state president of Congress. He did lead the party to an electoral victory. So he does have heft with him. It's not he's pretty boy.
He might have had a base in terms of the, constituency. But when I said that he started from the scratch, means building up the party.
Rustic charm always works with Delhi journalists. Yeah, Delhi journalists love Kanhaiya because of rusticity and not being able to speak. So I don't think, that's a bit of a generalization.
All right. Well, from my sources. Senior Congress leaders told me that basically nothing. So I would just like to discuss one thing very quickly. But before that, Anand, I'll just read this email out. I'm not reading the retort because that's over 1,000 words. This is from Sekhar Soma. First, let me express my best wishes to Team News Laundry for supplying us with excellent content and analysis and writing. Recently, knowing my fondness for the platform, my friend shared with me an article by Anand Vardhan on the depiction of the salaried class in pop culture. Though I admire the writings of Mr. Vardhan a lot, I cannot bring myself to agree with either the precedent or the arguments made in this particular article. Owing to the long discussion I had with my friends on the matter, I thought it would be perhaps interesting to share the same with Mr. Vardhan to know his perspectives on my understanding of the content. In this regard, I'm attaching a brief write-up. Well, this write-up will be a part of, I guess, all the mails. Since it's an op-ed, I initially wanted to write to Mr. Vardhan himself, but his email was not mentioned. So I'm sharing my views with your team as a rejoinder.
The email was sent to Anand, though. I had sent it to him. So he read it.
Please do let me know if you found his rejoinder relevant and what Mr. Vardhan may think of it. I would like to extend my sincerest apologies if any part of the rejoinder appears to be offending or confrontational. That was not my intention. I have passionately argued in the piece. Also, perhaps because it is an outcome of a heated argument with an engineer friend. Look forward to hearing your views and Mr. Vardhan on the same. Thanks, Soumya. No, we don't get offended. In fact, well, sometimes I do, but I think the rest of my team doesn't. But offense is fine, yeah. We like discussing stuff. I think it's healthy. Anand, can you just briefly first, for those of our audience who may not have read your piece or the other piece, briefly tell us your thesis and what Soumya's thesis is?
No, I am assuming that except Soumya and me, nobody read it. So
a bit about it then.
So yeah, it is so I would say it was it was a blend of a light piece and some social observations and how it's depicted in pop culture. So it was not a very, you can say a very dense and piece. It was a mix of both. So I just said that how there is a tendency in pop culture to romanticize certain kind of artistic free spirited people as against people who are having regular work life and the office going types,
right,
which includes engineers, and the defamation of engineer is a subtext to the kind of portrayal of office types as dull and boring types and being the less attractive options for romantic life or something like that. It was so I gave some examples in it, some from films. Also, I gave some examples which are not part of popular culture but a part of culture, like literary fiction in India. And so that was essentially the point. What he is saying is problem, because he is saying that I can't bring myself to agree with it, but that's not a problem. You should not begin reading an article with the exercise that you have to agree with it. So first, it is not a problem. You are welcome to disagree with it. There is no point of any dispute on facts. It's basically an article which his retort is basically about interpretation of different characters in different contexts. And my piece is about interpreting those characters in a different context. So there is also something about difference of opinion. I don't know what to say to a difference of opinion. You are entitled to have one. You are welcome to have one. And also, you see, pieces can't be about everything. Pieces, even academic thesis books, cannot be about everything.
As Einstein said,
they have a particular frame of reference and within which they try to address any point.
There's no God's theorem. Right. So thank you for that. Now, I'd just like to quickly end in next 5-10 minutes, if everybody could quickly give the view. Context is that there's a young stand-up comic in Bombay called Agrima Joshua. She had done this stand-up act, you know, a couple of years ago, where she had said that ye Chhatrapati Shivaji ka statue banega, which is supposed to be bigger than even Sardar Patel's statue. And basically, she was mocking that people will believe anything. Ki someone was saying that the statue will be covered by solar panels and then these solar panels will power all of Mumbai or something like that. And I said, achha, iski aankhon se laser beam bhi niklegi, or just that. So A, she was making fun of.
That's it?
Yeah, she was making fun of.
Statue, not Shivaji.
Not Shivaji. Even if she was making fun of Shivaji, I think that's fine. But A, she wasn't doing that. B, some insane guy and, you know, threatened her with rape. And then the other, it just became this contagion of people threatening her with rape. And after that, a guy called Aman Malik, I think is his name. He had done a stand-up thing a few years ago where he had made fun of this Ganesh Visarjan. And again, he was not making fun of Ganesh ji, although even if he was, it was fine, I think. He was saying that how people are getting drunk and dancing in front of Ganesh ji, and what would Ganesh ji be thinking? That, okay, so you've come here to do my resurgence, to PK, apne nipple ko kyun mar rahe? You know, he says, because they keep dancing, they keep doing this with that. I don't know, it's some Marathi move, I don't know what the fuck that move is. So that was his humor, and he also had to apologize.
Come on, that's not even.
Rohan Joshi is apologizing. So there's this spate of apologies. Now, I sympathize with these journalists, and I've said this in Awful and Awesome. We've discussed it at length. I do think that their apologies disappoint me a bit. I mean, wait for an FIR before you apologize. I mean, I think it's a Bombay thing. Bombay is used to apologizing to Shiv Sena no matter what happens. You know, five people come and say, fuck off, why are you celebrating Valentine? Okay, sorry. I mean, in Delhi, and I've written a piece on that, which
you
is
lose
why
your business, na?
Which is why I consider Delhi truly cosmopolitan, because the Shiv Sena, when they tried to do this in my presence in Wimpy's when I was at Newstrack, this Jai Bhagwan Goyal, he and his goons are hammered, and typical Delhi goons got together and bashed them up and said, we will sit here and celebrate. Who the fuck are you to tell us? Now, do you think, and of course, the Home Minister, who has nothing else to do in Maharashtra, tweeted that please take action against both the people who did the rape threats, but also against Agrema Joshua.
Yeah, which is quite rich. And the Gujarat police has arrested that guy.
That guy, the rape He's threat guy has been arrested. But there are 3-4 more who've given a rape threat. Now, I just would like the panel to weigh in. Are we, because I know now comics in Bombay are censoring what they're saying. I mean, Quint has done a piece. They tried to get comics to talk to them. No one wants to come on record. Everybody's shit scared. I think it's tragic. I think we're going down the way. And I think that while the Maharashtra government is a BJP, is a Congress Shiv Sena government, I think this is a tendency of the hardcore Hindu right, of this rape threats and how do you make fun of this person, how do you make fun of that person. Is it just a Twitter bubble that these people live in? Because I know journalists have been getting threats of rape and murder for the longest time. They haven't apologized, pulled down their stories. Is it a Twitter bubble that makes the problem bigger than seem bigger than it is? Or is it actually a big enough problem? And do you think it's a bit disappointing that all of them are like running to apologize? Every comic.
Yeah, and especially because Shiv Sena has been getting a lot of goodwill from the liberal circles, no? That, oh, new leader, nice, and we're happy to live here and not in a BJP-governed state. So happens that the BJP-governed state has arrested a guy, and whereas she had to apologize to Shiv Sena and all these guys. So, yeah, it's quite sad. And because if all these comics in Bombay could have come together and stood their ground for her, petitioned to the CM and said, look, you can't bully us like this. This is, you know, there's nothing. I mean, you can't just be screaming fascism and screaming, you know, death of freedom of speech when it comes to the BJP. I do think here, because purely because there's also the Congress in the power, in the government alliance, Congress, NCP and Shiv Sena, they could have actually really stood together, stood their ground and went to the government, even met the CM, met the Home Minister and said that this is really not, you know, you're also in the capital of the entertainment industry. It just doesn't augur well for any of this. Even for the scene, if everyone has to be bothered about making a joke of a statue of Shivaji, that's just too much. Hmm. And even for Ganesh, I mean, he's basically making fun of the revelers, not the Ganesh idol.
Right.
Forget the fact that whether you can offend gods or not, but you can, of course, offend people, yeah.
But I think one of the very funny bits, he was like, he said, Ganesh is really sitting there thinking, yaar, kya ye kaise peeke naach rahe? He says, itna sharab kaun pee raha hai? He says, let me call dad. He says, yaar, maal kaun phook raha hai? Referring to Shivji phookoing maal. So it was, yeah.
No, and it's hardly offensive.
What Manisha is saying is ideal way of, you know, dealing with the problem. But I think it's a big enough problem if you listen to these comics, because they are losing out their business. If they want,
losing businesses.
That's the main thing. And that's why they don't want to do the political.
So it's an economic impact.
Plus, I think in India, comedy as, you know, speaking truth to power, or the John Oliver or the John Stewart, or that sort of comedy is not what most comics want to do. Comedy still in India is about making people laugh, doing good business, getting a house full and making money out of corporate shows and other stuff. So I think, unlike journalists who can do nothing else but tell stories, so we can't really keep apologizing for every story we tell, because that would mean our business shuts. But for comics, they can just go back to cracking jokes on engineers, like Anand said, or on anything else. It need not be political or a commentary on society.
Miraj, your view?
This is an important point. I mean, whenever we tend to talk about curbs on freedom of speech, we usually talk about the government and the police and all. This economic pressure to conform is very important. I mean, if you don't have a job, if you can't make a living, how are you going to, I mean, it's easy to say, okay, all these comics should gather together, they have the privilege, they can speak up. But if tomorrow they don't even have a job, they have to struggle for a living, how are they going to speak up? I mean, you have to have that security to speak up, right? And this is one of, I'm going to recommend this piece at the end. It's a speech that Bertrand Russell gave it back in 1922. He talks about this, how economic pressure is one of the key, he lists three things that are the most, that are used most often by countries all over the world, societies all over the world, curb free speech and freedom of thought. One is education, another is propaganda, and third is this, economic pressure.
Okay, then after your recommendation, I will do a recommendation of Bertrand Russell on his contribution to pop culture. But Anand, you want to weigh in on this? I mean, you think I'm being too harsh on the comics to expect them not to apologize because they don't really have a choice? There's an economic impact.
Now, what if the apology was sincere? So if I sometimes I think that I crossed the line, I could have cracked joke without saying so. Or if a painter or cartoonist thought that depicting a particular deity in a particular way was not in good taste, there can also be an introspection, not only intimidation. So it happens. If you write something looking back at it, say 5 months later, you can think that I could have done away with this sentence. This was not required. So I don't know what the case with this particular comedian is, but it can sometimes happen also. Apology can come from introspection also, not only intimidation. So that is, there are cases where I personally think, but they need not adhere to it, that their choice of words leaves a lot to be desired. And the imagery they make, I think that's an easy way out to make some comical remarks, to use certain imagery, to use certain words. I think it lessens the efforts of a comedian's craft, because making people laugh in a clean way, or I'm not mistaking clean for being politically correct, but doing away with certain words can certainly help. That's my view. I'm not for censorship, but for their own, you can say, their own craft. There is a lot of escapism in using certain imagery and words to make people laugh. That's the easy way. Second is that comedy is also generational. One generation, the older generation, may not laugh at the jokes of current generation and vice versa. That is also there. It is also regional. Like I cannot bring myself to laugh at a lot of metropolitan jokes because I don't find them funny. Similarly, they will not find me funny. So it is also not of universal value.
So yeah, I think the aesthetics of comedy or taste is a different matter. And that, I mean, that's, I think, a no-brainer. It's an inevitability that it'll be different. I think the point is that, like, I wouldn't even go into the aesthetics of whether the jokes are funny or not. And I personally didn't weigh in on that, although I pride myself of having won 4 awards for my satire writing when I did Gustaki Maaf for 7 years. You see, when that Jeejee Charlie, what was that? Who were killed?
Jeejee Charlie.
Jeejee Charlie.
Now, you know, when that happened, I wrote a piece, and I remember shortly after that in a few publications, there was criticism of them. A lot of their humor wasn't funny. There was just like a few images of the Prophet Muhammad, this is balls hanging out, running. Like, it had no context. It was just fucking let's provoke. You know, let's... I don't think that conversation was relevant at the time. I had no exposure to their work. For me, they were just these 12 guys who had been shot because they drew the Prophet Muhammad. I saw their work after I got to know who they were. I didn't even know who they were till they were killed. I think the commentary on their work was irrelevant. It is what had happened. Now, I'm not saying people have been killed here. For me, the commentary on the work is irrelevant, and I've written a piece on this. We are getting to a stage where what the Prophet is, that you cannot make an image of him, are people like Chhatrapati and Modi are becoming. And I've written this in a piece in News Laundry, that maybe when I am strong and powerful enough, or have enough money in the bank to make sure that I can fight a legal case, because I think it's easier to protect yourself against physical harm. It's a legal harm that could completely compromise an organization. And the concept is, I want to start an image of a comic book, like we've done Amar Bari Tom Bari, that starts off with Modi being drawn, and there just being this black blanket that is the Prophet ka, because you can't draw him, right? And by the end of the comic, The prophet is fully drawn and Modi is this white beard floating around because he cannot be. He has reached that status. I think that would piss off everybody equally, but the likelihood of us surviving after that would be low. But I really want to commission that comic at some point. And I think the aesthetics are irrelevant. If I can't crack a bad joke, even if it pisses you off.
Yeah, where are we then?
It's a pathetic state of a country where Muttu Kodi Kovadi. Have you seen that? Have you seen Mahmood's humor? I mean, I find Mahmood's humor funny, but now because I have one leg in the woke canoe and one leg in the not woke canoe, I'm also laughing at his humor and I'm also cringing at it. Like, what? You know, even Chaturanar, Padosan is my father's favorite, all-time favorite films. He's married to a Tamilian. Even my mother thinks there's nothing wrong in it. I mean, like, what the fuck? But that's the India we lived in. Now, bloody hell. You'd make Padosan today in Tamil Nadu, your putla will get phukod.
Yeah.
That's where the fucking we are, man.
No, but that's a very important point. The right to crack a bad joke, yeah.
That's what freedom of speech is.
If it's just a bad joke, it's a bad joke.
That's what freedom of speech is all about. It's to accept views that are unpalatable to you.
I think I had made it clear that I was not in favor of censoring it. I said that my point is not against what he should do or what he should not do. But what I am saying that people can have different takes on comedy.
Yeah, of course.
And also, politically incorrect commentary is very much part of comedy. I think it derives its strength from that. So that is all fine. That is all fine. I was never against it. I was talking about aesthetics just as an add-on to the discussion that had already happened. I was not going to repeat those things.
Then. Anyone? Any Mahmood fans here other than me? Okay. Both of us. Clearly, sir, the woke generation doesn't like Mahmood.
I mean, not a fan. I liked his movies, but
he was so delightfully crass.
He was. Really.
He was so crass. It was delightful. Too good.
I like Kishore Kumar.
I liked him. I liked Johnny Walker.
Yeah, Johnny Walker wasn't crass. He was genuinely funny. And before we wind up, we just would like to talk a little bit about this flood situation in the Northeast. In fact, it's on the BBC also. It's the only Indian story that is on the BBC Morning Bulletin is the Assam floods.
And one Indian story probably missing from...
Well, to be honest, 3 days ago, Amitabh Bachchan and family being COVID positive made it to the BBC
Bulletin. Oh, yeah. We didn't... That wasn't part of the headlines.
Prakash Iyer has written, I liked episode 280 for a lot, especially discussion around Sindhia and cancel culture. One part about Hafta I find grating is looking almost everything through a prism of casteism. I think this episode showed a better glimpse of that flawed outlook. Panel pretty much agreed that names of villains had to do with casteism, and this is especially glaring considering Abhinandan has a pop culture podcast. The weird names like Shakal were a temporary phase around 70s, 80s when villains were like comic book characters. If you look into popular movies before Sholay or from 90s, Shiva, Satya, then you won't see that pattern. One of the most popular older films, Mother India, had a villain named Sukhi Lal. No doubt about which caste category that belonged to. And today we have a Trivedi, Sacred Games, Tyagi, and Tripathi in Mirzapur.
Mostly Brahmins.
And even there was a time around the 80s and later, that's when I grew up. Ghayal was Balwant Rai, Damini was Inderjeet Chadda, Bazigar was Madan Chopra. All fairly popular villains. But if you want to look at it purely through casteism, sure, keep raking. My take is they just chose certain names in 70s, 80s, which rolled off the tongue. With a nice punch. And no, Vikas Pandey doesn't have that aesthetic sound for the comic book style depiction. Waiting for Mehraj to add, what is good, bad aesthetics is defined by casteism at 3-2-1. Then he adds, I wrote that criticism regarding casteism by panel and later today I read this. And then he's linked to the New York Times piece on the cast at the Cisco. Felt a bit like egg on my face as I'm an NRI and an Iyer. Though I do think there is some merit in what I had to say.
Nobody's right that the names of late have not been the typical Daku names, like you were saying.
Maybe not the names, but the depiction is still there. Do you see how they, for example, portrayed Alauddin Khilji? He was a royal king. I mean, he was one of the greatest kings of his time.
Cannibals, aise kha rahe.
But Islamophobia.
All the bad characters in the movies these days and police characters are Muslims with coal-lined eyes and
topi. But Prakash, by the time one of my closest friends, she's a professor at creative writing at NYU. She wrote Monsoon Wedding, Kameene, Ishkia and many of these films. She's just been nominated onto the Academy, the US Academy. Sabrina Dhawan. She is teaching a course on how villains depicted Indian cultural and social ethos through the ages. So what when you're saying Mother India and all, that time we were coming out from a phase where there was scarcity and the baniya was the villain because they would thok. So roti kapda aur makan, right from Mother India to Roti Kapra or Makan, it was always the baniya or the guy who was hoarding grain. Apna, or that, you know, that other, the good daku, apne godam khol ke dikhao. Then she goes on to the bit about when there were the dakus of the Chambal ravines, when there was lawlessness and there was these bihars, there was bagis. And then she's gone on to show how, then it became the NRI thing. That time, the NRI, there was no clear villain. It was much more a clash of family and values of the NRI versus Indian. Then there was an entire Islamophobia thing, right from, you know, what you're talking about. So what I said, I agree with you that it is not just caste. I was saying a daku would never be called. Maybe I said Hindi movie villain, but it would not be daku Manisha Pandey. It would all be daku Gabbar Singh.
What he's saying.
Yeah, no, but not a daku, the villain can be. He's not a daku.
Okay.
See, Manisha, if you were a villain, you'd be the slimy one who's hoarding atta and not feeding us. You'd not be the brave one riding horse.
Not allowing people to enter temples. I would be the...
You know, Abhinandan Sekri would be the villain who was not paying his employees. Not the one who's taking over the world. So in that context, Prakash, I think what I said was accurate. And I would highly recommend that when NYU opens up again, you go sit in Sabrina's class. When she told me about this, that she's
Sabrina
preparing
wrote
this
a
thesis.
Book or a...
She's actually doing a course on this at NYU on Indian villains. You know, is like in the 70s, it was all smuggler. You know, during the when you couldn't take gold, every villain was a gold smuggler. So,
and Alauddin Khilji, actually, the problem is not just the. They got everything wrong. Like Khilji's, he was actually reciting a Persian pop song on the stairs, you know? Like, there's a very famous Persian pop song.
No, everything about how
they
eat chicken.
Which is passed off as some poetry.
They were very refined people. But anyway, so this part about good, bad aesthetic, it is defined by casteism, not just by casteism, but that's a one important point. I was talking to T.M. Krishna about, say, Carnatic music. Why is it that Carnatic music is this standard, this beautiful music, and say the Adivasi folk music isn't? Because the people who practice Carnatic music, they have the power in the society. Same way, in a culture, why is Ghalib's poetry considered more refined, more eloquent than, say, what you would call...
Hemoods.
For example,
Mir.
Usually, you go out on the street, there's a auto rickshaw fellow, there's a rickshaw fellow, he is listening to, like, what you would call this very bad, terrible Bollywood song.
Tum to thehre pardesi.
Jobi. And he is listening to it because it expresses his emotions or it expresses his feelings, his love, for example. And you go inside in your beautiful home, listen to Ghalib. Why are your feelings more important than his, more refined than his, more aesthetic than his? So it's because you have power, you have the cultural power, you define it by your standards, not by his standards. Right. Same is the case with dance, same is the case with literature. I mean, this country is a textbook example of
this. There is a difference between Ghalib and...
Yeah, I know, but I think
what I'm saying is generally...
He is more refined, I'd
why?
Say. I think there is also some pure assessment of art.
There is no objective assessment. This is a subjective
art
assessment.
Art is not, exactly.
How you feel it is different, but there's still, Ghalib's poetry is...
So, Ghalib's poetry to a person who understands Urdu language, who is a native Urdu speaker, and let him recite Ghalib's poetry. Would it express his feelings the same way it expressed in you? Probably
so that's not the only purpose of art, no?
But
to find my expression.
But I think what Mehraj is talking about, this is a very long discussion that has often taken place.
I wanted to say something about this whole business of sociology of popular culture. It gives material to a lot of people, even me. In fact, the discussion just now on my piece was just a kind of attempt of sociology of popular culture. The response was also it. But both, me including, all are at times guilty of overreading things. It may be a one-way traffic, because when the script writers or you may say the lyricists write something, there may be other considerations, not the kind of dissection that people subject them to. So it becomes a one-way traffic in that sense. Also, the discussion around castes, if you see places, say like Bihar, say considered in India as one of the most caste-inflicted societies. Now, if you have observed it for a longer period of time, you will see it just as one of the factors, not the overriding social factor here. So again, that application of template, that folly comes, that kind of flaw, because I see it as spheres of influence, different castes having spheres of influence historically powerful castes. Are same caste people benefiting from other castes or certain depictions or portrayals or spheres of influence? They may hitch their interests to other castes. So you have powerful caste leaders of other castes and other people trying to benefit from that sort of leadership. So there is a lot of within caste spheres of influence. It's not very that this is the decisive factor, this is the only factor deciding it. It may be one of the factors in some of the circumstances, but reading all social behavior, all attitudes around it, I don't agree with
it. I don't think anyone does. I think other than math and to an extent maybe physics, chemistry and biology, everything is not an absolute. Even economics is not. So yeah, so that's...
Quick point I'd like to make about this. So when we talk about caste, we usually understand it like casteism is just this upper caste oppressing the lower caste. Yeah. But that is not always the case. I mean, as Ambedkar recognizes, the sort of wicked genius of the caste system is that every layer has someone to oppress.
And even at the bottom, there are, you know, wheels within wheels which determine your power dynamic.
So this dynamic exists throughout the story. And when we are talking about, like the letter also said, the prism of caste, this is where we fundamentally disagree. I don't see this as a prism, as an aspect of society, Indian society. I see it like when we talk about the universe, about this fabric of time and space. This is the fabric in which all these things exist. It influences these things. It's not like that it is always the most motivating factor, most powerful factor, but it always affects every bloody
thing. It's the canvas. The rest is the painting, right?
I mean, another example, for example, so we talk about universe, we talk about God. Does the universe make sense to you without a God? A lot of people say it doesn't. It makes sense without a God like that being.
Whatever it is.
Whatever it is, it makes sense to them without that. That's fine. For me, for example, it doesn't make sense without that God person there, right? So when I talk about how the universe operates, how this thing operates, it doesn't make sense if I don't place that God figure there, right? Similarly, it doesn't make sense to me why, for example, only Dalits are 25% of the population, but only 2% of them graduates are Dalits. It doesn't make sense to me without explaining caste. It doesn't make sense to me why the basically 90% of the land assets, the capital in this country is controlled by upper castes who are like less than 20% of the population.
I think there's enough data. The US, which is a very data-rich country, NPR has done a whole series on this. I think it's very useful. But we are... across 2 hours, I would like everybody to quickly give their recommendations. I want to wind this up in 5 minutes. But before that, we talk about this every year, Mehraj. So since you haven't been here for 1 year, we talk about how the Assam floods come. Manisha tells the same story. I tell the same story. Raman tells the same story. On every dhaba I went to, there was on stilts that are 30 feet high. Homes were on stilts 30 feet high. Kaziranga has a road that bisects it, which is higher, 50 feet higher than both sides. So therefore, the whole park becomes a lake. What new do we have until when does this have to go on?
Seems like it's going to go on forever, because right now the toll...
How bad has the damage this year been?
It's around 92 is the latest toll, casualty figures. Around 5.5 lakh people have been affected across all pretty much every district. And to compound the problem, not just in the immediate term, in the long term, is almost 1.25 lakh hectares of crops have been damaged. And that the impact of that is going to be long term throughout the year. And what is the most saddest thing and the most thing that should outrage everybody is that this has been happening year after year, year after year. These lives uprooted, they settle again, uprooted again. And there's no solution is being found to this.
And this is also the place where the government expects people to produce documents for the NRC.
And another story which I read, this time people broke their own houses so that the bricks do not go away. So they wanted to save those bricks. After the floods they will build them back again. So they were
tragic,
breaking their houses even before the flood, you know, touched their houses.
To preserve the bricks. My God.
Sorry, I think I misspoke. It's 35 lakh people. 35 and a half lakh people, not 5.5 lakh.
5
and a half lakh is in the worst hit district, which is Dhubri.
The total hit are 35 lakh.
Yeah, 35
3.5 million. Yeah. What about that? Anyway, the annual flood. The annual Kosi flood hasn't happened, Anand?
It will happen. It will happen.
Around the same
wait
time.
For
it. Wait for Sam and
I mean, to imagine that natural disasters are like so inevitable in this country.
There are some districts which are on verge of being inundation, and Kosi, Gandak, these are two major rivers. Ganga is not a very, you can say, flood bringing river in India, in Bihar. Sometimes the Magad districts get inundated, but not for long. But the Kosi region and Gandak, and these are the rivers which bring, and some districts are reporting the inundation aspect of what will, from migration point of view, happen is that a lot of migration comes from the flood affected districts, and since many of them have returned, and
the damage will be more this time.
It is this time of the year that many new migrants go to metropolitan cities or say.
And because of COVID, they're not here, right?
Now they don't have that option because of this 16-day lockdown again enforced with a lot of strictness. And this is going to be a critical period, the flood period, because it is a period which brings a lot of migration.
To imagine, just cross my mind, to imagine, you can tell the state of the institutions of governance and accountability in this country just by looking at two things, that the natural disasters have become as much an inevitable fact of life as fake encounters.
Right. On that not very encouraging note, let's get our recommendations. Can we quickly have them? I'm going to give mine first, and I'll just urge everybody to give their recommendations quick. I'm recommending a podcast from NPR. It's called Hollywood's Blacklist. It's a fascinating story about this black guy. In any case, there are very few black people as executives who got a job in Leo DiCaprio's production company. And he started something just as a lark and it became a thing. It's a really fascinating story. I was just hoping that maybe we should start something like that. But do check that out. And there was another piece in The Wire that I found was an interesting read on Bapu Gandhi's racism. I don't agree with all aspects, but I think it's a nuanced take because, you know, these days it's trendy to say Bapu was a racist or he was a Mahatma. He was neither. He was a man. And that's that. But yeah, these are my two recommendations. Manisha?
One really short story, just to make yourself feel happy, is about this. This is a story about this 50-year-old lady in Meghalaya who cleared her 12th exam. It's a really sweet story in the Indian Express. You should just read it just so that you feel, just to cheer you up. The excesses of call-out culture in Atlantic, because we've been talking so much about the cancel culture. And there's an Amazon series called Rami. It's on Hulu. So those of you who have Hulu outside India could watch it. But those of you who are in India could watch it on Amazon. It's sort of like a Muslim Fleabag.
What's the name?
Rami. R-A-M-Y. It's really funny. It tackles fundamentalism, Islamophobia.
It's on Amazon.
Devoutness. Yeah. It's about this Egyptian-American guy who's devout but also debauched. So I think it's brilliantly written. It's by that comic.
Basically, stand-up just comic a human being.
Yeah. But it's really brilliantly done.
The one I already referred to, Bertrand Russell's, it was a speech, Free Thought and Official Propaganda, it's called. It was delivered in 1922. There are a couple of things which, I don't agree with, and history has proven them wrong in relation to religion. But other than that, all the topics we've been discussing about cancel culture, about freedom of thought, about nationalism, how it's an affliction, it covers all of it. It's worth reading and rereading.
Is it a big read?
No, it's a very thin book.
No, not that much. It's a small
book. Not that much, yeah.
Raman, sir?
Two articles in Indian Express. One written by Manishankar Iyer, and there is a rebuttal today by Pradyut. He is an ex-congressman.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. It's interesting. Where Manishankar Iyer is talking about the Congress ideology, the culture, and also the fact that in its DNA, we have just three leaders who can lead this party. Sonia Gandhi, Rahul Gandhi, or
Priyanka
Gandhi. So, then Pradyut today, he was with the Congress, and he has told that the kind of problems that he faced as a, and he said Tripura, he is from Tripura. So he said Tripura, I think, had the maximum votes for the Congress, the Northeast and all. So he said, despite that, the people like CP Joshi, the nomination culture that the Congress has and how it is killing the Congress.
So this ambition is not a bad word.
But I must be honest with you, there are certain things I'm very prejudiced about. Like, I cannot read a piece by Tavleen Singh seriously. And I cannot read a piece by Manishankar Rai seriously. I think they're both buffoons. But no, you're right. Maybe sometimes they make sense. But it's just that ek baar aapke dimaag mein ek bande ka ek banda joker ban gaya na, wo joker kabhi aap...
Joker off late hi bana hai, but he wasn't... I mean, he is a hardcore Congressy and all that, but he's still worth listening to and reading, yeah. I think.
I think he's a casteist, elitist, snobbish...
all that he is, yeah. He is definitely an elitist.
Insane man who lives in a bubble.
Not insane.
So,
and insane there's now. One... this Netflix pay... I mean, there's one mini-series on Salisbury's poison. Poisoning.
Oh yeah, I want to watch that.
In 2018, there was a poisoning in Salisbury, which has a population of 46,000. Russians had allegedly, you know,
I've heard of that
drug, you know, it affected. So interesting mini series.
Apparently, it was all not a hoax, but more like an inside job or something. But I mean, nobody knows for sure.
Anand, your recommendations?
Two recommendations today. I had this, I came to know about this venomous thought that today is World Snake Day.
World Snake Day?
Why on earth would there be a World Snake Day of all things?
So, World Snake Day. So
Anand, is that in the literal sense or a metaphorical
reading
sense?
About snakes. I had a few years back read a book about snakes in India. It's an interesting book about Indian snakes. Snakes of India, the Field Guide. It's by Romulus Wither and Ashok Kapton. So on World Snake Day, this is a venomous book that I would recommend.
I should give this to my father. He's a big snake fan. Like, I can't understand why.
Anand, I just want to give a warning to our Gujarati brethren. Don't start reading books about Khakhda and Fafda. He's talking about the ones that bite. So... on that bad joke and having
a bad joke.
Pissed off all our Gujarati audience. Yeah, carry on, Anand.
No, second is a Hindi novel and the English translation is also available and it's by Srilal Shukla, who's better known for writing the satire Raag Darbari. So, the book I am recommending is a novel and his lesser known work, but I think it is a more mature work from him. And perhaps his most accomplished work, and it's Suni Ghati Ka Suraj, and it has been translated into English, so those who don't know Hindi can read the English version. Yes.
Thank you, Anand. And on that note, please, can I urge all of you to subscribe, even though for the next few weeks, the Hafta is free, but my privileged and entitled colleagues still expect to be paid. So... those of you who just pay us to access the Hafta, please don't discontinue for the next 4 weeks. In fact, if you could use this time to share the Hafta wider so that it can become a habit for many. So when you pull it behind the paywall in another 4 weeks, those people do pay. Go to newslaundry.com, click on the top right-hand corner and pay to keep news free. And do support News Laundry because we depend on you to survive. And our survival, I think, is something that adds a little bit of value to some people's lives. So please help us to keep going. Today's song I have picked specifically for the Congress Party. So this goes out to them. This comes from the Ghatia Kavali Gharana of Kavalis. Have a good week. Have a good weekend.
कहीं दुश्मनी ने लूटा कहीं दोस्ती ने मारा गिला मौत से नहीं है गिला मौत से नहीं है मुझे जिंदगी ने मारा कभी बेबसी ने मारा कभी
All the News Laundry podcasts are available on Stitcher, iTunes, and any other podcast platform.
Please subscribe to News Laundry. Help us keep news independent. To catch all our podcasts on news, pop culture, current affairs, and sport, visit newslaundry.com. Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And subscribe to our YouTube channel.